Good morning, everyone. It's a joy to see so many people are joining us this morning. We are so glad to have you here with us. This is certainly an experiment all around. We are both on Zoom right now, and we are also broadcasting live on our main church Facebook page. We have a page and we also have two groups. The groups are closed groups and we have an open Facebook page. So that's where we are right now. And we want you to know that we are a church that is longing to be a place of welcome. And so this morning, as you join us for Palm Sunday worship, whether you are dressed up in a suit or in your pajamas, we welcome you here, and we hope that this opportunity to worship with one another will be meaningful for you today as we enter into the most holy week in our liturgical calendar. So I have a few things I want to share with you as you get started with us. First of all, we have a slide that is going to have our copyright disclaimer, because we have use of music through a license that we've purchased, as well as a streaming license. So we just want folks who might be looking at this video at some point to know that we have the proper things in place for doing the music in this service. I want to mention, as I did in the chat, that you should have things available to you for communion. That might be bread or a roll or a piece of pastry or whatever it is that you might have in your house, some crackers. You can certainly have juice, wine, whatever other beverage is best for you, but have those ready aside for that time during the worship service. You can chat with us in the chat box at the bottom of your screen. You click on that little icon and the chat box will open up to your right. You can send us greetings, and there will come a point where you're going to be able to chat with one another. So I want to suggest that the little blue bar that says all panelists, please click on the drop down on that and click on all panelists and all attendees. And that way everyone can see what you are saying in the chat box. Otherwise it will only be the worship leaders. We have been maintaining our prayer list. We are not going to share that publicly during this worship service, but I want you to know that we are continuing to maintain that, and we are continuing to think of the people who are on it, and I will be sending out that updated prayer list this week for your consideration, and if you have other folks that need to be added to it, we'd be happy to do that. As I said, we are streaming live both here on Zoom and on Facebook. I want you to know there's a little bit of a surprise at the end of the worship service with a bit of a spelling error that we are aware of, but this is something that took place some time ago, so we just acknowledge that, but I think it will be not a distraction at all when you are experiencing that part of worship. So friends, welcome. I'm so grateful to Jeanette for her cooperation this week. We've had many conversations about this whole situation, and she is broadcasting with us live from her music room, and grateful to have Jesse here, who's going to share our children's message, and we also have Stephen Brune, who is our liturgist for today, and Katie Brune, who is going to sing our anthem, our word in music piece this morning. So, so we are grateful to have all of them with us. And if you have the bulletin, I would like to invite you to take a look at the call to worship. I'm going to share that with you, God willing, on the screen now. So hold on just one moment. Okay, I had muted myself, so that wasn't going to be very helpful. So let's say this. I will say it, and those of you who are at home can say it on your own, or you can share it with your family members gathered around. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, rejoice and know that the Lord is in our midst. Jesus comes to us even now with joy and hope. Jesus comes to us to set us free from fear. Hosanna, Hosanna, glory to God in the highest heaven. Amen. And now we'll hear from Jeanette.
As we gather together to worship today, rather as we're all in our own homes, we'll take a couple moments of silent reflection to pray for those prayers that we can't physically say. Let us now join in our unison prayer of confession. O gracious God, on Sunday the city of Jerusalem cheered for you. They laid down coats and palms for you. They shouted, Hosanna, and called you king. But on Friday, they abandoned you. On Friday, they yelled, Crucify him. On Friday, you were in the wilderness alone. God, we want to be Palm Sunday today. We want to be Palm Sunday Christians, but we know all too well that we are also the Good Friday crowd. So today we ask for forgiveness. Forgive us for the moments when we deny you and your message of love. Forgive us for preventing the spread of the gospel. Forgive us for our sins. Amen. Friends in Christ, those who trust in the Lord say, God's steadfast love endures forever. Out of our distress, we call upon the Lord, and God answers us and sets us free. God is our strength. Let us live as people of forgiveness and grace. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Stephen. And now we will hear from Katie Brune, who's going to share with us our word in music this morning.
Good morning, everyone. I will be singing a cappella this morning, and I'll be singing Above All with words by Michael W. Smith. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, alike a rose. Trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, alike a rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. So like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all.
Thank you, Katie. That was beautiful. And now we will have our children's message with Jesse, and Jeanette.
Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's staying well. Happy Palm Cross or Palm Sunday. I'm excited to be here with you all. Today we're reading a story called The Colt and the King, which is a story about the donkey that Jesus rode in on. And please excuse Max and Molly, who are here with me, and if you hear them in the background, my apologies. Okay. I, said the donkey, am old, but still I remember a day long ago when I was just a colt. Spring had come to my hillside, the time when lilies bloom and sheep gave birth to their lambs. There's the old donkey. My owner took me away that day. My owner took me away that day down to the village gate. We waited there till strangers came, men who said they needed a colt, one that had never been ridden. All right, Max, you want to see the story? Okay, here you go. All right. My owner sent me with them. I pulled hard against my rope, but the stranger's hands were strong. I had to follow where they led. Nap time. We walk through the twisting streets where shouts and the rumble of wagons drown out the sounds of the doves and rob the wings of its song. We came at last to a place where olives grew. A noisy crowd had gathered there. They swarmed like bees on ripened figs. I bared my teeth, my gray coat twitched, my neck grew tight with fear. In the midst of all it stood a man. The strangers called him Jesus, but many called him King. Jesus saw me tremble. He came and stood beside me, his hand upon my back. In his voice was a river of quiet, in his touch a shelter of peace. And my fear flew away like a bird set free. The people cut branches of palm and waved them in the air. They tossed their cloaks upon the path. Then they lifted Jesus up to set him on my back. They danced and sang as we walked. Blessed is he who comes to save us. Blessed is he who rides triumphant on a colt. Although his legs hung low at my sides, Jesus did not feel heavy to me. Happiness made my hoofs tap high, and joy was in my breath. My heart welled up with wonder like a barrel that fills with rain, and I knew that truly I carried a king. Yet how I longed to take him away, far from that worrisome crowd. I longed to take him home to my hillside. There I would share my friends with him, the mooing cow, the clucking hen, the lizard, the cricket, the crow. I have not seen Jesus since that day, But still, even now, my long ears prick listening for his voice. I know that someday he will come and I will share my straw with him. I will soften it with my hoofs so he can lay down to rest. The little donkey was so happy to carry Jesus on his back. And now I know Jeanette has been working before all of this with all of the kids on Little Gray Donkey. So I think she's going to share that with you now. And if you know the song, sing along with her. I know you all have been practicing. And I hope everybody has a great Palm Sunday.
I hope the words are available on the screen. I don't know. But please, everybody who knows it, sing, because I can't sing too well. But you see, I have the little gray donkey right here with me. And I have Jesus in the background here. I can't hold them all, but I'm going to play with the little gray donkey on my piano bench here. Here we go. Ready? It's a great donkey, it's a great donkey, it's a great donkey.
Thanks, Jeanette. That was great. And now we're going to hear from Stephen, who will share our scripture texts with us for today.
Morning. So our first reading today is from Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and 19 through 29. Oh, wait a sec. I'll let Kathy get it up on the screen. Happy Palm Sunday, everyone. Perfect. Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and 19 through 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Our gospel reading for today comes from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Amen.
Thank you again, Jeanette. Hopefully that was inspiring for all of you who are missing being able to be in the sanctuary and singing that together. I want you to know when it comes to music on Zoom, it is meant to be a meeting platform. So it's hard to have a bunch of people all singing together because they have, there are various delays and it ends up sounding rather muddled. So I hope that in your homes, you are all singing with gusto along with the lyrics. And at this time, I'd like to invite you to bow for a moment of prayer with me. O gracious and merciful God, as we have walked this Lenten path together, it certainly has been filled with the unexpected. And these days you are asking us to look deep within ourselves. And these times are asking us to reflect on our lives. During the season of Lent, we are often asked to humbly repent of the ways that we dismiss or abandon or reject your ways and your will for our lives. And you at all times are asking us to consider what a life of faith really means for us as individuals and as a faith community. And you know that that question could be no more important now than ever. And you also know, oh God, that we don't know all the answers. We know there is yet more work to do, and there is certainly uncertainty ahead. We know that the cross looms on the horizon. We sometimes prefer to skip right over to the Easter celebrations. So help us, O God, to face the crowd. Help us to face our fears. Help us to experience in this time of physical separation a more personal encounter with Jesus, not only in this coming week, but in the days ahead, so that as he promised, we might have new life, abundant life, a life that is transformed by your love. We pray today in his name. So friends, when I was growing up, one of the fun shows that we used to like to watch was Candid Camera. And what was particularly fun about that show was catching people by surprise and watching what their reaction would be. And I remember that sometimes the activities that they were doing with one another would be to see how people would respond to something, particularly a surprise. And I remember this one episode where they were filming a person who was taking the elevator. And he would go into the elevator and somehow they had someone else in the elevator with them so that they could film what was going on. And he would do various things in the elevator. And everybody knows that when you get into the elevator, you're supposed to be quiet. You're supposed to look up at the numbers and don't look at anybody else and don't talk to anybody else. That's kind of the elevator etiquette, right? And so this guy would go in and do everything that was not elevator etiquette. And he would particularly do this to try to see if he could get others to do it with him. And that was really the funny part, is there's this human inclination. When other people around us are doing something, we will tend to do it too. He might have clapped, or he might have, you know, suggested that people twirl around, and invariably, if someone else was willing to do it with him, the other people in the elevator were also willing to do it with him. So, you know, it was just very funny, but it was a commentary on the human nature of, you know, I know you've been in an audience where everybody kind of has that sense they want to clap, but everybody waits until somebody starts, and then everybody else joins in. So you can imagine what a surprise it was for the folks along the road as Jesus was entering into the community, that who is this person who's coming along the road? He's arriving in a form that's the equivalent of how royalty arrive into the town, and yet who is he? And some people had heard of him. Some people knew of the stories of him, of his healing, of some of the things that he was preaching and saying. They had been with him on the mountainside or in the various villages. They had heard of his healing. And so some were compelled to line the road and be there in his presence. But others didn't know of him yet. But because a crowd was forming, they all had like behavior, and they gathered there on the side of the road. So think about this. You're going about your business that day, and up until this point, you hadn't heard of him. And suddenly, here's this crowd beginning to form, and something's happening, and you want to know what's going on. And so you go to investigate, and there's all those people. They're cheering, and they're throwing their garments on the road, and they have plucked palm branches, and they're waving those in the air, and they're casting them on the ground ahead of him. And in the distance, here comes this person riding on a donkey, a gesture of significance and position, but you don't recognize him. But even so, you join the crowd and you begin waving branches and calling out. You learn his name is Jesus, and you realize that he must be someone really special to be garnering all of this attention. So without any further knowledge, you too begin to cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Did you know that the word Hosanna actually means save us? We often think of Hosanna being this kind of joyous exclamatory remark, but it actually means save us. The people were joyously receiving the person that they were convinced was the long-awaited Messiah, the one who would come to save them. So you call out his name, hoping for a closer glimpse, and as he passes by, you turn to your neighbors and you say, who is this? Now, sometimes it's helpful for us to imagine ourselves as part of the biblical story, imagine our participation on this festival day, and the actions of the crowd aren't that difficult to imagine, even if we were a bit confused and we didn't know much about him. But what's more challenging, I think, is also imagining ourselves within the story of the crowd that we know is going to be coming later this week. The one, the very same one that will be yelling, crucify him, crucify him. Even if they didn't really mean it, they followed what the rest of the crowd was doing. Even if they could have had him released by Pilate. And here we say to ourselves at this distance, some 2,000 plus years later, oh, I would have been one of those Hosanna people. I wouldn't have been in that crowd yelling, crucify him. But, you know, based on some of these social results of how we behave as humans, it's really hard to resist behaviors when others around us are participating in them, even if they seem unusual or confusing. There's kind of a mob mentality that takes over. So on that day, there were those in the crowd who already knew Jesus. They had seen him before. They heard of his preaching and teaching. They were witnesses who must have gathered by the road and cried out when they saw him coming. They all knew of his countercultural messages of love. They knew that he was a person for all people in the face of the Roman occupation. And they were drawn to him with cries of Hosanna, save us. And as a result, other people were drawn to him too. So what was it about this man? Who is this, they said, causing great curiosity in the group. And who are we in the crowd? Are we the ones rushing to the roadside, crying out because we know who he is and what he's capable of doing? Or are we perhaps in that outer crowd, still at a distance, not really exactly sure why we should have a more personal relationship with him, why a personal understanding of his teachings would be life-changing? We hear those words these days, that you should have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, sometimes they're a bit loaded, and we aren't exactly always sure what that means when we practice Christianity. However, don't just completely dismiss the words. Who is this? Who is Jesus personally for you today, especially in the midst of what we are experiencing together? How is it that we can continue to practice our faith and really rely on it and have it be a foundation for us during these very unusual and very strange times? Jesus was one who was hailed by peasants and lepers and cripples and day laborers as the Messiah. He was one, though every inch a man from the country and a peasant, he rode in as if a king on a donkey. Who is this who was dragged through the streets of Jerusalem and hauled to the execution grounds? Who is this that hung on a cross, abandoned and forsaken? Who is this for you? Friends, it's hard to have a neat and tidy answer to those questions this day, and that is okay. But also, I want you to know it's worth pursuing thinking about it, thinking about the answer for yourself. I don't believe it's just a superficial belief, an outward piety, but really something that can help cause a more deeply personal transformation in your life. If I didn't believe that, I wouldn't have followed the vocational calling in my life. Our lives as Christians are lives informed by the ways and the teachings of Jesus that are transformative for ourselves and for others. We are sometimes in the lowest of lows, down in the pit, but we can even still be brought up from it because of a relationship with Jesus Christ. It helps us to rise up and to live each day, whatever that day may bring, whatever uncertainty is on the horizon, and see its possibilities in a spirit of hope. And you see this happening all around. Yes, we hear the difficult news broadcasts and all the numbers and so forth, but you also hear these incredible stories of human compassion and the ways that people are coming together, even though they are separate. Jesus is a source of healing. Jesus is a source for those who have no voice of their own. Whether it be people who are persecuted for their sexual orientation or their race, their color of their skin, those who are hungry or homeless. These are all people who Jesus loved deeply. When we read in scriptures, we hear the stories of his life, and we learn about what he said and what he did. We ask ourselves, who are we in the crowd? And how will we walk this journey to the cross? And what does that mean? So that when we arrive at Easter morning and the next day and the next, we will still be able to say who Jesus is for us. And are we willing to go there, even if it means our whole world might be turned upside down? All the things that we used to think and used to believe might be changed because of him. I'm not able to answer that for you. That is your own work to do. But I can tell you today, personally, that it has made the greatest difference in my life. And all I know is that God does not seem to be done with me yet, and God is not done with you yet. So as we ask, who is this? We know one thing for certain. This is Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, in the flesh. God whose spirit is always companioning us through life, no matter what it brings. Friends, even in the face of our knowledge of the cross, how can that news bring us anything but hope? Amen. So for prayers of the people today, we're going to just have a little bit of a moment where folks can type their thoughts and prayers into our chat box. And if Jeanette is hearing me, she might be able to just play some noodling music while we do that a little. And if not, then we'll just have a little bit of a moment of silence. But you can feel free to share with us those prayer requests just for a short time. And then Stephen will lead us after that in the Lord's Prayer. Stephen, will you please share the Lord's Prayer with us?
Of course. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, today, just a brief moment of offertory reflection for you. Obviously, these are strange times in the life of the congregation, and we are experiencing a time of such uncertainty that we have not had before. And yet we know that the work of the church is still of value and continues on and is probably needed as much now as it's ever been before. And yet in the midst of having said all that, I want to just acknowledge that I know that there are so many who are suffering right now, financial challenges of all kinds, because so many different folks from different walks of life have lost their jobs, their businesses are closed, their restaurants are closed, there's a great challenge with income coming in. So I want to acknowledge the both end of that the church still continues on and does its work, and we absolutely need to support that in whatever way we can. But I also want people to know that that we are aware that things are very different right now, and that people's ability to contribute and to use their resources and be generous may be curtailed in ways they could not have foreseen. So in that regard, if you are able and you can continue to support the church with your time in some way, your particular talents, your resources, we are grateful for that. And if this is a time for you that is a challenge, we certainly acknowledge that as well, and we definitely understand that. And so we are grateful for whatever you are able to do in continuing support of our ministries together. So thank you. And now I invite you to use the chat feature again, and you can send greetings of peace. We are calling this in the bulletin, chatting the peace of Christ. So go ahead and share greetings of peace with one another, and again, Jeanette can play some little doodling music, whatever that is. Friends, now would be the time to get your communion elements that you have set aside and have those ready. And I'm going to, first of all, share with you, my communion elements are from a little set I have, which is like a mini paten and chalice. So here's the bread. Here's the cup this morning. We're going to be sharing together in a communion liturgy that is written by Marin Tirabassi. Marin is a ordained UCC minister who is an incredible writer, and so she has written this communion for us to be shared with the churches who are worshiping online during these very strange times. So there are parts of this that you can participate with where you are, if you have the bulletin with you or on your screen. There are some unison parts, and you can say those to yourself if you're alone or with the family members that you're gathered with. So hear this invitation to the table. For Holy Communion this morning, I invite you to lend Christ your table. On the first day of Holy Week long ago, people throughout Judea arrived at the dusty gates of Jerusalem, primed with Hosanna in their hearts, and Jesus asked to borrow a donkey. On the Thursday that followed, Jesus rented or was given John Mark's mother's upper room to celebrate the Passover with the disciples. And on the afternoon of the resurrection, Jesus was invited into a house in Emmaus and used the bread that hospitality was available to break and bless. So lend Christ today your table, your bread, your cup, your heart. For as the disciples told the person who loaned the donkey, the Lord has need of it. We are one bread, one body, one cup of blessing. Though we are many through all the earth, and in this church community, which is scattered, we are one in Christ. In your many kitchens and living rooms, rest your hands lightly upon the elements which we set aside today to be a sacrament. Let us ask God's blessing upon them. Let us say together, gentle Redeemer, there is no lockdown on your blessing and no quarantine on your grace. Send your love, your spirit of life and love, power and blessing upon every table where your child shelters in place, that this bread may be broken and gathered in love, and this cup poured out to give hope to all. Risen Christ, live in us that we may live in you. Breathe in us that we may breathe in you. Friends, we remember that the Apostle Paul wrote letters to congregations throughout places we now call Greece, Turkey, and Macedonia. And they were the first remote worship resources. Our online service has a long heritage. The communion words sent to the church in Corinth were these. For I received from the Lord what I also handed to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he blessed it and he broke it. And he said to them, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then in the same way, after supper, he took a cup. And he said to them, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for all. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread, friends, and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let us, in our many places, receive the gift of God, the bread of heaven, sharing it with one another now, and say together, we are one in Christ, in the bread we share. orphans, let us, in our many places, receive the gift of God, the cup of blessing, sharing it now with one another as we say, we are one in Christ, in the cup we now share. Let us pray in thanksgiving for this meal of grace, rejoicing that by the very method of our worship, we have embodied the truth that Christ's love is not limited by buildings made with human hands, nor contained in human ceremonies, but blows as free as the Spirit in all places. And let us pray together. Spirit of Christ, you have blessed our tables and our lives. May the eating of this bread give us courage to speak faith and act love, not only in church sanctuaries, but in your precious world. And may the drinking of this cup renew our hope, even in the midst of pandemic. Wrap your hopeful presence around all whose bodies, spirits, and hearts need healing. And let us become your compassion and safe refuge. Amen. Lord, just as we have entered Jerusalem with you, be with us in all the Jerusalems we will be facing this Holy Week and in all the days to come. Guide our steps, encourage our hearts, give us abundant faith to know who you are and to follow you. Amen. Friends, bear with me for a moment because I do have something I want to share with you, but it seems to have gone from my screen in the way that it was there before. So hold on for a moment, please.
Ride on in majesty, our hymn speaks to us of a transition, of moving beyond the celebrations of Palm Sunday into the events of Holy Week. And our symbols of faith The Christmas tree and its trunk becomes now in Holy Week our cross. And we bring that cross into our sanctuary with an awareness of all of the things that Christ carries for us in this moment on that cross. And we accompany the one who will accompany us always. We accompany Jesus on the Via Dolorosa.
He was bleeding from a beating
Friends, we are so glad. Let me just change my computer setting over here. Hold on. There we go. We are so glad that you have been able to be with us today. I hope that this virtual experience came close for you to the experience you would have hoped for being in the sanctuary. And I'm certainly grateful to Jeanette for all of her music, and to Stephen for all of his help with the liturgy today, to Katie for her beautiful music, and to all of you for showing up and being here. I think that at some point during our broadcast, our Facebook Live piece cut out, but we've been recording the service from Zoom, so we should have the service in its entirety to be able to share with others who were not able to be with us. I want to let you know there are some things coming up for Holy Week, so please pay attention to your Constant Contact and to the Facebook pages. If you are not somebody who's connected in that way, we'd be happy to help you figure that out. And there's going to be a variety of things that will be available to you online this coming week. And we certainly invite you to join us following this in a different meeting, a meeting setting where we can all see each other and talk to one another. We'll have a bring your own coffee hour shortly. And so hopefully you got that link that is also in the Constant Contact that was sent out. And it was also posted, I think, to our closed Facebook group. So we'd love to see you there. But in the meantime, go in the peace of Christ and in the care of one another. Amen.